I'm about to swallow this robot.
Wish me luck. It's easy.
This Pillbot is a tiny submarine that can navigate through your stomach, and you can even pilot it. Plus, it's only about $35 worth of hardware. The future of medical robotics is very quickly approaching, and it's going to be a wild ride. Why do this?
This is a mystery. I have no idea what's going on inside.
Here you go. You're looking inside your stomach.
Pillbot is a moving eyeball in the human stomach. It's really just the tip of a modern endoscope.
Technologies like these could dramatically change the way we get information about our bodies, allowing us to catch and treat diseases maybe even before we experience a symptom.
Theoretically, this is the modern healthcare system for hundreds of millions of people if we pull this off.
That is a live feed of a burp.
Yes, that's what a burp looks like.
That is an actual burp.
Plus, it's like driving the magic school bus in your own tummy. So sign me up.
Went down the wrong tube.
Will your next checkup require an Xbox controller? Buckle up, Arnold, because we're about to misfrizzle this shizzle. My apologies to Snoop Dogg.
We're going to get to know each other really well.
This is Hard Reset. One of the best movies of the 1980s was Inner Space. It's about how Dennis Quaid gets shrunk down and injected into Martin Short. Okay, I haven't seen it in well over 30 years, so I have no idea how well it holds up, but man, did it make an impression on me as a kid. Well, it made an impression on this guy, too. Meet Tori.
My father showed me this movie, and I just got a kick out of it. As a kid, I just assumed, yeah, that was a cool movie, but at the same time, that must be what we're working on, right?
Tori is the CEO of Indiotics. That name doesn't accurately convey how amazing they are. They make tiny robot submarines that can navigate in your stomach. I suppose Tiny Stomach Robots Incorporated was already trademarked, though.
We're actually offering real-time three-dimensional investigation inside the human body, basically doing what an endoscope does.
Later on, I'm going to swallow one of these robots, but before I do that, I want to know where they come from and how they're made. This seems like the kind of technology that would come out of a university research project. But it actually started in Black Rock City, known to most of the world as the home of Burning Man. If you've never been to Burning Man, there's only a few things you need to know. One, bring lots of water and hydrate. Two, last year was better. And three, people go all out to build incredible, immersive experiences and artistic endeavors. Like this pair of giant Tesla coils, which was built by Tori, Alex, and a bunch of other talented people.
Burning Man can be a place where you can express your creativity in ways that you can't necessarily do it at work. Our group of friends had been united around this idea of building a world record Tesla coil and taking it out to the desert.
I have the power!
And we were pushing the limits of technology related to high voltage and high energy. Giant lightning bolts kill you in a heartbeat, and yet they're beautiful. As you know, Burning Man is difficult, and the technology didn't work the first year. But we came back the second year, and it only worked a little bit. And we came back the third year, and it was working better. And we came back, and we came back. And there was some magic in that.
Sometimes you need to push for several years before anything actually comes to fruition.
And at the end of that, we were like, well, what else do we want to do? What do we want to do next?
So Tori, Alex, and the team of people that came together to build these giant Tesla coils in the middle of the playa decided that their next challenge would be to bring their blend of talents to making something very small. The Pillbot is itty-bitty, but it's still a bit larger than your average supplement capsule. But it used to be a lot bigger.
Well, with Pillbot, we needed to start with something tangible because we needed to show the world and our mothers that we had any chance of ever succeeding with it. And so we decided to build at the size of an American football. At that scale, you could get Raspberry Pi electronics off of Amazon. It's kind of like junior high school science fair level tech.
It was literally, you know, soldered wires and duct tape. It was absolutely that first prototype.
And we called that Pillbot. And Pillbot showed that you could do elegant three-dimensional control with a multi-pump jet system.
It was massive. And then there was this progression in order to get it smaller and smaller. The roadmap was pretty difficult.
Shrinking Pillbot down from pool-sized to elephant-sized to horse-sized to smaller horse-sized to human-sized was an engineering journey that took 5 years.
So these are all the different iterations that you guys have gone to. Well, not maybe all of them, but the major milestones, is that right?
There are dozens and dozens of different moments, right. But these are some of the big hits. The real step forward, though, came from leaving the, you know, football to Red Bull size. Getting down to thumb size was the last thing we were able to do on our original money.
To go from here to here inside of a year.
We were cooking, right? Like on the mechanical side, we were just relentlessly finding smaller motors, smaller batteries. So yeah, just over a year to get to the swallow. But when we swallowed it, the thing was almost twice the density of water, meaning it would sink like a stone in your stomach. And at best, you'd be motoring around over the wrinkles, usually just getting stuck.
Normally, I would have said, wow, this is just too hard. There's too many things, right? In terms of size, in terms of battery performance, in terms of compute, right? In terms of manufacturing, we were off orders of magnitude, plural, right? We were literally 100-fold needed to be smaller, lighter, cheaper. We started, we knew we had a lot, but we kept at it and we kept at it until finally we were only like 5x off.
A lot of what made this possible is probably sitting in your pocket. Smartphones. This device is built on technologies that have fallen in price and skyrocketed in efficiency since they found their way into mobile devices.
Pillbot, in its current embodiment, is a tricopter. It has three pump jets that are capable of squirting water in any of six different directions. And basically, it's a floating little eyeball that's capable of moving by emitting jets of water.
Here we're starting to put together some of the thrust barrels.
Right.
So you can imagine there's sort of a back end of the robot,
right,
which is the thrust section, right?
Right?
This is all the motors and the propellers and the lumens.
The Pillbots are currently assembled on site, and they're made from biocompatible materials so that they'll be safe to ingest.
How does it taste?
Doesn't taste like anything, but I can imagine in the future someone will want cherry flavored, lemon flavored robot, I don't know.
The jets in the Pillbot are the same vibrating motors in your phone that let you know when Craig has finally texted you back about dinner tomorrow night. RSVP at the last minute. Classic Craig.
Let's go look at motors. So this is the vibration motor from a cell phone.
It's amazing.
It's a commutated DC motor, super inexpensive. It costs probably about 20 cents. We're able to kind of take those motors and prop our propellers on them.
The batteries in these need to be able to push out a lot of voltage really quickly. Surprisingly, electric car technology is what has paved the way for that kind of performance.
Let's talk batteries. Lithium-ion battery. Like, that battery is now super effective because of electric vehicles and because of our cell phones. There's been billions spent into the chemistry and the design of the anode and the cathode and the connectivity and the electrolyte and everything that goes into that battery. Things at that scale are difficult. You can't even hold on to it. So we spent a lot of time making custom equipment to hold and then do testing and certification. A lot of custom tools that we are always designing and building in order to work at that small scale.
Right.
Every single corner we would take was a surprise and a challenge. But some of the big ones were, wow, can we get the parts small enough? The traditional way of doing individual boards and having connectors wasn't gonna work. The smallest connector available was way too big for us. It took up too much real estate.
The team at Endiotics was only able to make this work by using flexible circuit boards that use custom chips.
And so we can optimize the design of the circuitry and the chips and the entire layout. So there's a thing called an application-specific integrated circuit where we might take three or four chips and put them all onto one custom chip. Not only does the robot get smaller, it gets cheaper as well and more efficient. This is that flexible circuit, that three-dimensional origami circuit that contains all of the electronics, the motor driver, the processor, the FPGA, think of the camera and the lens, all of the data that exists on the whole system, as well as all of the electrical connections, the antenna, the connections to the motors. But that's it. That contains everything in that little tiny circuit there. We wanted to show that we could actually solve some of the fundamentals of driving a robot at a small scale and a small size. We spent a lot of time on that.
If we really want this to be ubiquitous across the planet, that robot should be $20, $10. Like, imagine if you're getting to that scale, right. Now you can go almost anywhere on the planet and almost anyone can go ahead and get access to it. So that's where it's going. You know, $35 now, you can cut that in half and maybe cut it in half again.
NASA could have built this 10 years ago. It would have cost, you know, $1 million or something. It would have been insanely expensive. We need to make this robot single-use disposable and really inexpensive.
All right, what's next?
That's it. We go swallow robots. Are you hungry?
I'm starving.
Let's go eat a robot.
I haven't eaten a robot in a long time.
Let's go eat a robot. All
right. Do you know a place around here?
I know. I have a favorite. I have my favorite.
So what's it like to play Mario Kart in your own tummy? I'm about to find out. In order for this to work effectively, I had to swallow a bunch of liquids and then stop, drop, and roll to coat the inside of my tummy. They did offer me a couch to do this on, but I just decided to do it on the concrete floor. Because that is how I roll. Get it? Whole lot of setup for that dad joke.
The way that you turn on a hermetically sealed device is we use an external light.
Right.
And so there's a photodiode inside. Once you kind of activate the photodiode, the robot itself will turn on. I'm gonna hand you this robot,
cool.
And you get very comfortable with it.
It's pretty amazing. I mean, it's definitely larger than like a Tylenol. Oh.
That's me turning the motors on.
Yeah, it's got some oomph.
Right now, Pillbot is about 13 millimeters in diameter by about 30 millimeters in length, which basically means it's just about the biggest thing most people might be able to swallow.
Shall we?
Bottoms up.
All right.
Down, down, down. Here we see we're going down the esophagus. There's bubbles and there's some, you can keep drinking the rest of that water.
Okay. Okay. So this looks like dune.
Yes, there's right definitely there. a sandworm there. So let's go ahead and start driving around.
Wow, I don't even feel that.
Right? There's nothing. So I'm moving around now.
The Pillbot is a submarine, so you need some marine for it to sub in. What I mean is that you need to drink a lot of water. That inflates your stomach like a balloon and gives your Pillbot a nice clear medium to look through. Sorry guys, apparently I have some mucus in there. And, oh, I was wondering where that went.
Because Pillbot moves with its little pump jets, we're actually offering real-time three-dimensional investigation inside the human body, basically doing what an endoscope does in real time with no ifs, ands, or buts.
The Pillbot is ballasted to stay level, which means it's always looking at the horizon. It can't currently look up or down. So in order to see the top and bottom of your stomach, you need to lay on the ground and roll around a bit.
And so even if it's not perfect, even if it's not tiny, it's actually small enough to actually go and do some work. So we're very excited about the concept of a practical, humble beginning for Pillbot that certainly sets the stage for further advancement.
When's the last time you ate something?
Last night I had a salad at like 6.
Okay. Gosh, this should be good.
I mean, but also my stomach is a wasteland.
So my live swallow started out great, but seemed to go awry when the Pillbot wasn't able to maneuver very well.
Now we'll go back to your back and then onto your right side. There we go. All right, let's see if that stabilizes. Yeah, I don't think I'm gonna be able to get much better. All right, you're up.
All right.
Oh. It seems that my stomach had too much mucus in it. Maybe because I was recovering from a cold? Hard to say. The point is that this technology is still in development. They're still working out all the bugs. Just like their Tesla coil project at Burning Man, you need to be willing to keep working at it. So we waited a bit and tried again with a different model and had better results. This model is designed to always look up, so you can examine the top of your stomach more easily. I was also able to get a much better look at my long-lost Lego friend. See you in 13 hours, buddy. Tori, who has swallowed like 50 of these things, however, had much better results.
I think this is 48.
Oh.
Yeah.
Thanks for the correction. Anyway, We watched him do a demonstration with a gastroenterologist.
I think what we're trying to achieve here is a complete gastric exam, so that's why we're trying to drive this to a point where we can say we've looked at the entire stomach. We're looking for gastritis. Big one is gastric cancer. Those are the big pathologies. A lot of people have postprandial abdominal pain, dyspepsia. And in an exam like this, once you rule out cancer, which is the big question, you know, that answers the diagnostic dilemma and prevents need for more invasive tests like an endoscopy.
This is how Pillbot could be doing the work of a modern EGD or upper endoscopy on a vastly higher scale. Instead of diagnosing people with late stage cancer, we need to figure out how do we migrate GI health from symptom-based care, which we really think of as sick care, into health care, where you can actually go into someone who is generally healthy and confirm that or find something that they might not actually be able to feel.
It's worth noting that there have been ingestible cameras before, but they're passive. They just drift along and take photos along the way. What makes Pillbot different is the fact that it can move around on its own.
Some people on the team are very excited about using pure visual data being used to create almost like a Google Street View style environment that you can actually, in digital form, use to construct a 3D environment.
If we can catch things like stomach cancer, colon cancer, or even pancreatic cancer early enough, they could be far easier to treat. So the potential impact for this is huge.
The vast majority of people just don't really have access to modern GI healthcare. The idea with Pillbot, we believe that these tiny robots can basically transport the capabilities of an endoscopy suite basically just into the palm of your hand. If someone has a internet connection, then awesome, you could have a gastroenterologist on the other side of the planet do a telemedicine procedure.
So what will it mean when we can explore the insides of our bodies? Picture a scenario where looking inside yourself wasn't just accessible, but an everyday occurrence. As this technology gets smaller and smaller, we could see these little medical probes in far more places, constantly checking for infections or other illnesses.
We haven't saved a life yet.
Right.
At some point in the next few years, we are going to get a call from a doctor, and they're going to say, we caught an early cancer and we cured it. That is when Pillbot stops being a dream and it becomes a reality.
But the future might not just be about monitoring our bodies. We could also use robots to administer treatment inside of us, delivering targeted doses of medicine or even performing surgery.
The scenario that we see unfolding over the next few years is that tiny robots in the human body should be able to start going to work very soon.
The concept that says, oh, hey, I have this one tiny little issue right here in this one little corner of my body, and how am I gonna solve it? I'm going to swallow all of this medicine. It has to go through your entire body in order to affect this one tiny little thing. How inefficient is that? Let's just go there to that spot and fix that thing, and we can do that now.
Imagine taking a sample of tissue or blood from a disease site and getting biosignatures from that sample, and then being able to deliver a custom compound, like a biological compound, right back to the actual location that's like tailor-made medicine for that patient.
Some of these ideas might seem impossible now, but it was only a few years ago that this seemed impossible.
I wonder if we're still stuck at the top.
Oh, I see something there. Oh, that's what I left in there for you. I recognize it.